a couple of weeks ago, our friend and colleague Tony Boselli was diagnosed with the coronavirus, COVID-19, sent to the Mayo Clinic here in Jacksonville. He's gone through it all. He's back home now, and he's back on Jaguars Happy Hour today. Tony, it is good to hear that voice again. How are you, sir?
Well, I'm doing better, JP, and I appreciate you. It's been quite a few weeks, but I'm feeling better. I'm home from the hospital, and I'm on the right side of this thing now.
Tony, we're going to break some of this down. We'll talk a little football, too. This is a football show. It's been a while since
you've been on. That'd be good.
We'll get to that.
It's been a while.
There's been a lot going on between now and then. How did this start? What was your initial reaction to it, the symptoms? When did you find out? When were you tested? And then all of a sudden, when were you at Mayo?
Yeah, so a few weeks ago, I guess it would 2 weeks ago from yesterday is when I got tested. And the reason I got tested, I started feeling first just like a cold. Didn't think anything of it. And maybe some allergies or something, but woke up a Wednesday morning feeling really lousy. And that same morning, I got a phone call saying that I was around an individual that had tested positive. And so at that point, I called my doctor at Mayo and said, hey, here's what's going on. I feel great. And I just found out that I'd been around somebody. So they got me in and I got tested that Wednesday. And stayed at home and just kind of hung out waiting, and then found out Friday, 2 weeks from tomorrow, that I was positive. And at that point, was still feeling okay, but started going down a little downhill over the weekend. Thought I was getting better. And then Tuesday of last week, really started feeling bad. And throughout the day, it was going the wrong direction. And Wednesday, mid-morning, called my doctor again and told him what was going on. And he sent me to the hospital. I thought I was just going in to maybe get some fluids and some medicine.
Sure.
And next thing I knew, I was there 5 days.
When you get in there, how do they greet you at the door? I mean, this has to be, obviously, they know that you have it at this point. And then you're in the hospital. What happened the next few days after that?
Yeah, so I'm really fortunate. I mean, the people are great throughout the healthcare system here in Jacksonville, and I was fortunate to be at Mayo with great people. So they called ahead; they knew I was coming, and so I was greeted with an individual who at the ER who was aware I was coming and was in the full mask and making sure they're completely covered head to toe, and they wheeled me into the emergency room into a private room away from everybody, and start doing tests and x-rays on my chest and everything. And that's when the pulmonologist came in and said, you're not going anywhere. You're going to stay. We're going to put you in the ICU for a while.
Wow.
And that was a little bit of a shock, obviously. I mean, number one, you don't think it's going to ever be you. You're going to get it. And then when you do get it, you think, I'm young. Only 47 years old and completely healthy, have no health issues. This will be kind of a quick thing, turn it around and get back right to it. And next thing you know, you're in the ICU and got a bunch of machines hooked up to you and you're in oxygen. And it was quite a interesting time. So I was there, ended up being at Mayo for 5 days, half of that time in the ICU. And then Monday was able to kind of turn the corner and get good enough to come back home. And then I've been at home the last few days and really starting to head in the right direction.
Tony Boselli with us on Jaguars Happy Hour, his first radio appearance since returning home from the hospital. We're also simulcast on the Frank Frangie Show currently on 92.5 FM. What goes through your mind, Tony, when you're in intensive care and you're by yourself and that's really all you have time to do is think about it?
Yeah, I'll tell you, it's scary. That's for sure. Your mind runs, and obviously, that people are dying from this, and you're in the hospital, and you're in the ICU, and no one can cut. You can't leave the room, and no one can come see you unless you're in a full, protective suit and all the protective equipment. So it's really scary. Your mind runs, and you know you can't see your family or anybody until you get better. Thankfully, I'll tell you, the people, you know, the doctors, you know, the PAs, the nurses, I mean, the techs, I mean, everybody that I dealt with was unbelievable. And they, you know, they take their own, you know, they know they're at risk, and thankfully they have the right equipment, but they're still at risk, and they come in there and serve you. And so they made it a lot better. I mean, even all the way to the individuals that come in every day to clean my room. And so that was, I mean, seeing somebody and, you know, these individuals that are taking care of you and talking to you and trying to encourage you, that was helpful. But it was pretty interesting experience. And there's a lot of times to kind of lay there and just you and your thoughts.
Tony Boselli with us. You get moved back into a general room, and now you're obviously back home. At what point did you see or find out that the story was on social media? Mike Freeman of Bleacher Report had tweeted out your situation. It was known around town. It wasn't a public media thing yet, though. But at that moment, it changed. When did you find out about it, and what was your reaction to see it?
Yeah, first of all, I want to thank all the good, you know, all the media in Jacksonville, and a lot more of my friends, and they knew, obviously, you know, and I'm closer to some than others, and some of them that I talked to, they knew I was sick, and I wasn't responding to any of the media at all, from that standpoint of wanting to talk to anybody, and each of them really respected my privacy. You know, I got sick, and I knew it was a big deal, you know, out there publicly, but I was feeling pretty lousy and a lot going on and a family to worry about and everything else. And so I just wasn't ready to talk. So thank you to all the Jacksonville media and a lot of the national media that's friends of mine that kind of knew something was going on and were respectful of my privacy. So I was purposely not saying anything. Not that I would never, just when you're that sick and you're not feeling good, it just wasn't the right time.
Sure.
And the fact that, you know, Mike Freeman decided on his own without ever even trying to reach out to me to do what he did, you know, what do you want to call it, ethics or morality? I don't know what the exact term is, but it was sure didn't feel very good as you're laying in the hospital and you get an alert on your phone that someone's talking about you, and especially when you're, you know, that sick. So that was tough. I mean, I couldn't even tell all my friends that I was that sick. And so a lot of them found out through him.
Sure.
And I didn't like that. And I was pretty upset, but it happened. And he made a decision to do what he did. I completely disagree with it. I think it lacks professionalism, but that's his choice. And that's what he ended up doing.
Has he reached out since?
No. I mean, he never reached out before to ask, you know, at least have the decency to ask me, if, you know, and find out. I mean, talk to maybe some of my family, what was really going on. You know, God forbid, what if I was dying in there and you're out there reporting this thing? I just think it's unfair to, I mean, it's a personal matter, you know, and to do that without even trying to reach out was really, really disappointing.
Tony Boselli with us, pride of the Jaguars left tackle, co-host of this show, Jaguars Happy Hour, his first radio appearance since returning home. Glad to hear that voice again. Now, moving ahead, you're back home. Are you in the clear now? How far away are you from being in the clear? And what's your appeal to everybody listening today?
Yeah, you know, I took a test yesterday to see if the virus was there. It was negative. It was gone. So, but because I was in the hospital, I'm taking, you know, back to that back-to-back test. I took another one today, assuming that comes back negative as well. Then I'll be clear. Well, I guess one of the silver linings in this deal for me is I'm probably the safest, you know, person to be around because I can't get it. I got all the antibodies, and I can't obviously give it to anybody because, you know, I can't get it any longer. So that's the one positive, that once I get through this, I'll be able to go out and be safe. And so that's a good thing. So, you know, and then, you know, the overall message is, you know, this is real, obviously.
Sure.
I think sometimes we all do it. I'm no different. you hear about these things in the news, you hear of people that you don't know, or maybe it feels like it's a far, long way away or a different place, and you kind of question it, and you're like, oh, this is not going to happen to me, or I'm young, I'm healthy, you know, this is something that only affects somebody who's old or has other diseases, you know, a compromised immune system, whatever, and it's just not true. It is real. It can affect any of us. You know, 47, healthy, I got it, took me down pretty good. But even if I got, and I guess the other thing is, even if it doesn't, you know, maybe you are fortunate and the odds are in your favor because you're healthy and young, but you can still give it to somebody else. And so I think it's time right now to listen to the healthcare professionals and the experts, what they're telling us, because it is real. They're not making this up. And really think about our community and think about each other and everyone around us.
Tony Boselli with us. People have been distancing from me for a long time anyway, Tony, so I don't really have to.
It's just it's probably pretty natural for you right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, this is like another week. Tony, let's talk a little football, shall we, and wrap up the conversation here. I don't know how much you were following in intensive care, obviously, but Yannick Ngakoue has been in the news the last week or so, tweeting about the Jaguars' business practices lately. The Jaguars, as of the last we heard, don't have any official offers from any teams for him, and I don't think they're planning right now to send him away. I think they want him to be here, but it sounds like he's willing to sit down, and I think he's had enough of the Jaguars, it feels like.
Well, I mean, here's the reality. I mean, they got him under contract because of the franchise tag, and I've been, reading through Twitter and stuff a little bit here and there, and obviously, he's a big deal, and he's a very good player, and he's a guy that's done a lot of really good things. And the Jaguars use their leverage; they have it. And Jan's going to have to make a decision, and I can't imagine him not playing if it comes to, making $19 million or nothing. I know he wants to be traded, but you have to find a partner who's willing to give you what you want. And I think the Jags are going to sit back and be very patient because they do have the leverage. And I think they're probably pretty confident that he would play if push came to shove because, he wants to make his money. It's unfortunate it's come to this. It's obviously you have a guy who's upset, mad. And this is what happens a lot of times in organizations. You feel like you've been cheated or done wrong. It gets emotional and a lot of feelings comes up. And a lot of bad feelings come up, and those are hard to overcome. But this is the business side of it, and a lot of times in these situations, one side's not happy, and right now John's not happy, and we'll see where it goes. But my guess is at some point in the next 2 weeks, I think the Jags will probably get an offer that they want that makes sense to them, and then you'll probably see Yannick traded. But with that said, you have to find somebody who's willing to pay Jan the $21, $22 million a year, or that's what it's reported he wants. There has to be a trade partner that's not only willing to give you the draft pick, but is willing to pay the long-term deal that Yannick's looking for. So they have to find the right trade partner. I think they will. And my guess is before the draft that Yannick will be on a different team.
Tony, it's weird that football seems so irrelevant compared to what you've been through the last couple of weeks. But
I tell you, JP, it puts things in perspective. That's for sure for you. And I think for me going through something like this, you try to find, what can you learn from it? What can it tell you? And I think for me, what it's done is more than anything, it's reminded me of, how many great people I have in my life and great friends. And I talked about the healthcare workers and they're just complete studs. I mean, the people that dealt with me are studs. There's no other way to say it. There's no regard for themselves and to take care of me like that's awesome. But also, I mean, the people I have in my life and my family, so many good friends too, from the Jaguars organization and people at my church. And I can't tell you how many people have dropped meals off and have taken care of my family when I was being really sick and making sure we have everything we need from medicine to everything else because everyone's been quarantined here. So really thankful for, I feel pretty blessed by God, for a great life, but part of that is the great friends and the great people that he's put in my life. I mean, had so many people reaching out to me and still do by text and asking what they do and bring food over and everything else. It's just been amazing. So I got great friends. And so those things you look back and you're thankful for. And And I get to work for a great organization, you know, like the Jaguars. Also, my other company that I work with has been great, Optum. I mean, so you feel pretty blessed to have that many people care about you and really kind of take care of you in a time like this.
Tony Boselli, first radio appearance since returning home. We love you, man, and glad you're getting healthier by the day, and I can't wait to see you soon, man. Thanks for your time today.
All right, JP, love you, and the good news is as soon as I get this last test back, you don't have to worry about social distancing for me, so well, we can do the show. We'll do the show together.
Yeah, come on over to the house next time.
Perfect.
Tony Boselli joining us. We'll talk to you soon, man. The pride of the Jaguars, left tackle, joining us on the phone. Back in a moment. Great visit there with Tony. Obviously, good to hear that voice and glad he's doing well. You'll hear the podcast of that coming up on Jaguars.com and the Jaguars official podcast pages as well. Back in a moment, John Osier joins us with more after this. It's Jaguars Happy Hour on the Jaguars Digital Network.